Welcome to Superior Profit Weekly Market Roundup, 7th April 2018. I am Sagar Nandi, Chief Analyst and Trader at Superior Profit, based in Singapore. I will not take time to introduce myself. If you are interested to know more about me, the company, Superior Profit, or more importantly, how it may help in your trading, you may visit our website superiorprofit.co and click in the About menu. Before we begin, we go through the standard disclaimer. This demonstration is for educational purposes only. It is designed to share information on Superior Profit's trading system. The information presented here should only be used by people who are aware of the risk inherent in trading. Past performance is no guarantee of future return. Superior Profit is not an investment advisor. This session is not for any recommendation of buying or selling stock or any other instrument. Superior Profit will have no liability for any investment decision made by its audience. As usual, we'll look at key commodities, oil and gold, that tend to impact related stocks. Not always, as we will see in today's session. Oil and oil-related industries diverged significantly this week, and we could identify that immediately from QH. We'll discuss more about that in today's session. A rising tide lifts all boats. That is same in the stock market as well. That's why we study the broad market using market breadth of Nasdaq and NYSE and technical charts of the four broad market ETFs. That helps us take trades only in the direction of the broad market. We also try to align our trades with the industry's direction. We can identify the direction using industry scorecard and heat map, as we will do in today's session as well. Along the way, we may go through some examples, trade ideas that were shared in our traders forum, and try to identify potential trades for the coming week. That was the last slide of the presentation. We'll now move to live system. Before I start the analysis of charts, what do you think of the market condition? If you would like to share your view through the Q&A panel, do you think it is bullish, bearish, or it's better to stand aside? Okay, wait and see. That's right. Wait and see is probably the wisest decision one can take right now. And we will see that based on objective data analysis. Let's begin that. We start our commodities analysis with oil. We are looking at the oil ETF USO using weekly backdrop chart and daily hop-on chart. Together, we call this at-a-glance template because this template helps us identify if there is a low-risk entry opportunity at the right edge of the chart in a few seconds. Using unambiguous checklists and consistently color-coded signals. 2 weeks ago, oil was right at the watermark resistance level where bearish headwind had appeared earlier and from where price could fall down significantly. Watching that, I mentioned that at this point, we would not be taking any long trade. Next week, oil dropped somewhat, and this week it dropped even more. The decision not to take a long at the top, where watermark resistance and bearish headwind were there, turned out to be a wise decision. At the right edge, price is very close to the memory support lines in daily and also the memory support line in weekly. It is also near the yellow direction line. Right now, there is no trade signal in US oil for swing trading. For day trading, one may see if price tries to go below the memory support but reverses from there. If it is doing that, Then switching to real-time fine-tuned chart, one may be able to take a very low risk, precise long entry for day trading purpose. For swing trading, we have to wait for an appropriate setup to appear. Just now we saw that following Q trade setups allowed us to stay away from oil trade, and the same is true for gold. We are looking at gold ETF GLD using the same at a glance template. Last week I had mentioned, looking at the weekly backdrop color magenta, that this week, even if we had a cyan color candle in the daily chart, we would not be having any gold flow long trade setup. That turned out to be true. Gold went up on the cyan color candle, but for the week it didn't move much. In effect, moved sideways. We can see that more clearly from the weekly chart. We have a very narrow body candle with long upper tail as well as long lower tail. That is an indecisive shaped candle. Following Q trade setups, of which there was none, we stayed away from taking any trade in gold. At the right edge of the chart also, there is no Q trade setup. We will wait patiently for the next trade setup to appear. We looked at the two commodities. Now let's look at the broad market analysis. By the way, every week I also share a text on market breadth analysis. You may access that from the market menu and market breadth item. Here I provide a summary of what we discuss in the weekly market roundup, looking at the market breadth chart, as we will do now. Every week we study market breadth using NASDAQ composite index and NYSE composite index, both using weekly charts, and three pairs of internals: new high low at the top, advanced decline in the middle, and up down volume at the bottom. Because this analysis is using broad indices and weekly charts, it is to be used more for longer term investment decisions, not for swing trading so much, and certainly not for day trading. Over the longer term weekly interval, both NASDAQ and NYSE are in uptrend. They will remain in uptrend until the memory support lines are broken. Last week I discussed that NASDAQ had very indecisive shaped candle. NYSE had somewhat bullish shaped candle, though it also had small upper and lower tails. This week the indecision has increased. NYSE has a much wider range candle, however the body is very narrow. That is, it has very long upper and lower tails, showing high degree of indecision. Interestingly, it precisely hit the memory support line during the week and went up from there. This memory support had been touched many times in the past. Here, here, probably here, and now again in this week. This is providing robust support to NYSE. In NASDAQ, price fell down. We can see on closing basis, it is lower from previous week's close. It also precisely came to the memory support line and went up from there. Therefore, for NASDAQ also, the memory support lines, two of them are here, are providing good support. If we look at the internals, the new high lows that were instrumental earlier to move prices up, they are less effective now. From last week to this week, new high low almost didn't change for both the indices. Both of them closed below zero. For NYSE, it slightly declined. For Nasdaq, it slightly went up. But for all practical purposes, it didn't have much effect on the overall market. Hardly any change from previous week. Whereas the other four internals declined sharply. And they flipped from sharp up move of previous week to sharp down move of this week. In fact, if you see past 3 weeks, they came down sharply, went up sharply, and came down sharply again. True for all the four internals. Came down here again, came up, came down again. Same here. Came down sharply, went up sharply, came down sharply. This up-down, up-move, coupled with the very indecisive shape candles of the indices, are telling us that it is not safe to take any trade right now. There is a high degree of risk of being whipsawed or getting stopped out. It may be better to see if the market is having clearer direction before taking the next trade. Last week itself, I analyzed and discussed this indecision. That indecision became even more this week. Last week, using top-down analysis, I could still try to look for some trade opportunities. This week, I found very few, if any, good opportunity. Not only at the end of the week, but during the week as well. And the queue system is designed in such a way that using sonar or using top-down analysis, applying the trade setups and unambiguous checklists, if you are not finding good trades, meaning trades that are matching one of the trade setups and are giving us reasonable reward risk ratio, if we don't find such trades in, say, 30 minutes of time in a day, that means the market is not right to trade at the moment. That was true for last week, and for this week it became even more true. If you had run sonar, you would have probably found the same, that it was very difficult to find any suitable trade opportunity during the week. While the internals were whipsawing down, up, down, the sectors did the same. We'll look at sector analysis shortly. Before that, in summary, we can say for broad market, over longer term, they are in uptrend. However, indecision is very high in this week and was high in the previous week. Therefore, it is safe to stay away from the market right now. Let's now study the broad market ETFs, and we'll see the same conclusion holds true from that analysis as well. We are looking at SPY using at a glance template. Just like NYSE broad market index had a bigger range week, SPY also had a bigger range week. Again, the body is narrow and it has very large upper and lower tails. The indecision this week became even more relative to the previous week. In fact, in this area in the daily chart, when SPY dropped heavily, many people were suggesting that it will continue to drop heavily from that Monday. However, looking at so many supports both in weekly and daily, at that time I had mentioned that it will be difficult to break the support, not so easy. That turned out to be true. So far the support is holding. In fact, this week there was a bullish headwind signal in SPY. That also provided some support. So far, it is effectively moving sideways for the past 2 weeks. There is no swing trade opportunity at the right edge of the chart. Overall, is it moving sideways or is it bearish? If we look at the daily chart from the right edge, then we have to say it is moving sideways, not bearish. We just looked at the broad market internals. There also we saw the internals went down 1 week, up 1 week, down 1 week again. So there also we have to say objectively based on data that market is moving sideways, not necessarily bearish, not necessarily bullish. It may feel bearish. Why so? Because the news media is bombarding us with negative news right now, this and that and whatnot. However, if we base our decision on objective data, we have to say that in recent times, market is moving sideways, not bearish, not bullish. And the same conclusion will be reached from the other ETFs as well. Let's look at QQQ. In the weekly chart, QQQ dropped relative to previous week's close. This is same as what we saw for NASDAQ broad market index. However, just like the broad market index, QQQ also has very long upper tail and lower tail. The shape is indecisive. It precisely hit the memory support and went up from there. In the daily chart, it displayed a bullish headwind that also confirmed the support. So far, the supports of the memories in daily and weekly and the support from the bullish headwind signal, they are holding. Bullish headwind signal doesn't mean that there is a bullish headwind trade setup. The trade setup was not there. However, looking at it, we'll be cautious about taking short trades. That would be a good idea. And the memory supports also told us not to take any short trade. Looking from the right edge, it is more bearish than SPY. However, there is no short trade opportunity, neither is there any long trade opportunity. We are now looking at Dow Jones Industrial Average ETF DIA using at a glance template. Again, we have a very indecisive shaped candle in the weekly chart, even more indecisive than 1 week ago. Much larger upper tail and lower tail and very narrow body. Interestingly, DIA also displayed a bullish headwind. There is no trade signal right now. For swing trading, we may wait for a proper trade signal to appear at the right edge. IWM through at a glance template. Once again, very indecisive shape candle. The indecisiveness increased relative to previous week. Why we say so? Because the range is wider, but having both upper and lower tails in the weekly chart. This also doesn't have any trade opportunity, swing trade opportunity at the right edge of the chart. If we combine the four ETF study with the broad market study, then we see that there is massive indecision as well as flip-flop going on in the internals. And it is best to stay away from the market. We'll reach the same conclusion from sector analysis. Let's move to that now. Every week we study 11 sectors across 3 review periods. The red bar represents performance of this week, green bar performance of 1 week prior to the red bar, and blue bar performance of 2 weeks prior to the green bar. Together, they constitute 4 weeks or about 1 month of performance. Any bar coming to the right of the zero line represents the sector went up, and any bar to the left of the zero line indicates the sector went down. This immediately shows us that all the sectors went down this week. All the red bars are to the left of the zero line. And 1 week ago, that is represented by the green bar, all the green bars came to the right of the zero line. So 1 week ago, every sector went up. This shows two things. One is that massive sector level indecision is continuing. In fact, this week, every sector went down. 1 week ago, all had gone up and the week before that all sectors went down. This should be down. So it is showing the same down up down move as we saw from broad market internals. Better to stay away from the market. This indecision tells it is time to stand aside from the market or enter fewer trades, and that too after careful 360-degree analysis, aligning as many edges as you can in favor of your trade. As I mentioned already, it was very difficult to identify such trades this week. When there is whipsaw over weekly periods, we need to look at a broader interval, longer interval, to unearth the proper strength of the sectors. If we look over 1 month period, we find that only two sectors gained, real estate and utilities. Energy was practically unchanged. I had analyzed this relative strength of real estate and utilities in several roundups, including the one of last week. Using this sector rotation analysis and industry rotation analysis, we could start looking for long opportunities in real estate before others came to know that this is a safer sector right now. But we were ahead of the game. Later on, we'll see there is some reason to be cautious in real estate as well. Probably it is better to stay away from taking new longs in real estate. I'll come back to that when we study the decelerating industries. Information technology is the worst performer this week. In fact, information technology, industrials and financials, all these three sectors were very strong earlier and turning weak now for several weeks. This sector rotation was discussed in previous roundups as well, warranting caution for taking new long positions. In fact, multiple very well-known technology stocks had displayed bearish headwind reversal signal some time ago, and those signals came at the very top. Using those signals, we could protect our profit in long positions and even look for shorts. I had discussed some of these reversal signals that came in FANG stocks in a recent blog. Let's have a quick look at the blog. Not sure if any of you had a chance to read the blog. The blogs can be studied from education blog page. And whenever a blog is posted, usually that is notified in Twitter, Facebook, Google Plus also. If you follow any of those channels, you will get notified on new blog posting. This was the blog that I posted on FANG stocks, reversal signal that predicted fall of FANG stocks at the very top. FANG stocks are Facebook, Amazon, Netflix, Google, very strong stocks. These were four of the key stocks, large stocks, that made the market going higher in past months. Interestingly, one young trader was chatting with me on WhatsApp. On 22nd March, this gentleman sent a very positive message on Amazon that in the last 92 trading sessions, Amazon has added over 300 billion to its market cap. This is more than what Amazon was worth in April 2016. It added more to its market cap in 92 days than it did in its first 5147 days as a public company. I didn't try to validate the data. He is a smart guy, CFA actually. So I took his word for it. But when everybody starts being very bullish on a stock, in general, I tend to be cautious. So I replied, amazing, time to be cautious, I would think. But it was not only because of the fact that Amazon had gained so much in last 92 days, but because the chart was giving bearish signals. One of those signals was this bearish headwind signal that came at the very top. In fact, it was on 13th March. And on 22nd March, when this young trader sent me the message, we had this magenta flow color candle. That was a go with flow short trade setup. So we had a go with flow short trade setup in Amazon after a bearish headwind signal at a time when everybody was thinking of Amazon being very large, and of course it is very large. People were telling that it is going to hit $1 trillion. It may hit $1 trillion market cap, but before that we could take a short trade using the go with flow short trade setup and book profit at the lower boundary. At minimum, we could protect our profit in long position. I have mentioned in several previous sessions that when similar stocks or similar ETFs show bearish headwind signals together, it is necessary to be even more cautious. This bearish headwind signal didn't come only in Amazon, it came in other FANG stocks as well. This is Netflix. Here the bearish headwind signal came on 12th March. Again, it could catch the very top of the stock. And on this magenta color candle, we could take a go with flow short trade and book profit at the lower boundary. And this is Google. Here also a bearish headwind came, not at the very top. The very top was at this price point. It came near the double top, and since then it went down. We didn't have any low risk go with flow short trade setup in Google, but at least we could try to protect profit in any long position that we might have. These signals are very useful in protecting profit and sometimes taking reversal trades, not only in the short direction but also in long direction, not only in USA market but in other markets as well. I shared one trade idea in our community on this stock. This is a very well-known stock in India, one of the large auto manufacturers, Tata Motors. They own the Jaguar brand now. Here the bullish headwind came. In the FANG stocks, the bearish headwind came at the top, and in Tata Motors, bullish headwind signal came at the bottom. And in the community forum, I analyzed the weekly and daily together at that time. It also gave us a bullish headwind long trade setup. When I shared it in the community, if you keep an eye on the India market, you saw that India market was actually weak. However, this stock was looking stronger. I did a 360 degree analysis and it gave us a very low risk long entry opportunity. And though the India market didn't recover, Tata Motors went up nicely. Not only it went to value area, it hit the upper boundary and the profit was booked at the right edge of the chart. This again illustrates the effectiveness of this unique signal that helps us protect profit, number one, and sometimes allows us to take a reversal trade at the very top or at the very bottom. Information technology continues to be very weak. Let's look at the QA to see how the sector rotation is going on. This is QA. Every time we open QA, it analyzes 11 sectors and more than 270 industries across 12 monthly review periods and more frequently over recent periods. Let's look at the sector panel. For each of the review periods, it assigns a score and heatmap color. Small score, 1, to the worst performer, and a large score for sectors. It is 11, we have 11 sectors, to the best performer for each of the review periods. Also, it applies a heat map, cyan to the strongest one, magenta to the weakest one, and color gradient to the ones in between. This gives us a scorecard and heat map table that instantly tells us which sectors are strong, which are weak, and equally importantly, which ones are transitioning from strength to weakness or vice versa. 5 days is the primary period. We use this period's score and heat map to decide entries, both for long-term investment as well as swing trades. We can sort over 5 days period, smallest to largest. The weakest sectors will come to the top. We can see that information technology was strong earlier, cyan color, now turned weak, and in fact over 5 days it became the weakest sector. In fact, this transition from cyan to magenta happened when the FANG stocks were also starting to drop and when the bearish headwinds had appeared. The bearish headwind had appeared on Q charts also at the same time. QQQ charts, not Q charts. In fact, the bearish headwind on QQQ also at the same time. So there were many bearish signals. The bearish headwind could catch the top of the move in information technology sector. Right now it is very weak, so we'll stay away from any long entry in information technology. And the sectors that were weaker earlier, especially real estate and utilities. Real estate and utilities, these two rows, we can see both of them were weak earlier. Score for utilities was 1 here, 2 here, very weak. And score for real estate was 2, 3. Two of the weakest sectors earlier. Now, both of them are turning cyan. So they are stronger now. Based on that, we could identify some long trade opportunities in real estate earlier. And we could take it right at the time it was transitioning from weakness to strength. There is another piece of information that we can deduce from this graph, the sector performance graph. We saw whipsaw, we saw sectors all went down 1 week, up next week, down this week again. However, if we see the strength of the decline, the length of the red bars, some of them are quite large, infotech, industrials, but compared to the up move of previous week, they are relatively smaller. So market is bearish, but not as bearish as it is told in the news media. We saw that from the sideways move in the ETFs, the indecision candles, and we can see that from the sector performance as well. The up moves percentages of previous week in aggregate were reasonably larger than the down move percentages of this week. So we will not try to take any short position right now for that reason as well. Let's look at the industries to see what message they convey. We are looking at the 10 best performing industries of this week. In this week, 49 industries were up and 124 were down. This is a weak market. Much more went down than went up. Still, industries were not as weak as it had been in the recent past, in recent past down weeks. In some of the previous down weeks, there were not even 10 gaining industries. However, this week is much stronger than that. We have more than 10, actually 49 gaining industries. And the best performing industries increased between 2 to 4%. That is interesting, isn't it? The news media is very bearish, but on charts it is moving sideways in indecision candles, and in fact there are significant numbers of industries that went up, and the top performers went up not by very small percentages, even in a down week. 2 to 4% is not very small for industries move, especially when all the sectors went down. So we have some hidden strength in the market, or at least we can say the weakness is not as much as it is told in the media. In fact, 7 of these 10 continued their upward momentum from the previous week. So they did flip-flop, and the other 3 reversed from loss of previous week to gains of this week. These 3 that flip-flopped from loss to gain are coal and consumable fuels, diversified metals and mining, and home building. Home building turned positive from negative, and it is the best performer. In these best performing industries, I looked at the stocks using QH drill down. I found these 2 stocks, TPH and William Lyon Homes, WLH. They are having good earnings growth. They are moderately valued. Both broke out of resistance in daily charts. Weekly backdrop is bullish. Both may have potential long trades in coming week. There is no long trade setup right now, but we may keep an eye on them. WLH also has a short squeeze potential. Let's have a look at QH, look at the best performing industries, then drill down to home building and look at these stocks, TPH and WLH. In QH, to find the best performing industries, we can sort over 5 days, largest to smallest. Home building is the best performer. It is cyan color over 5 days period. It had some recent weakness. Before that it was strong. Then it weakened and now strengthened again. This may be a time to look for long opportunities. So I drill down into home building. For drilling down, instead of using QH, I will use the stock scorecard. That will be faster, because the data is already downloaded in the offline stock scorecard. Let's look at the home building stocks. In stock scorecard, we can search for the home building stocks by filtering on the industry column. We have multiple stocks. We can sort them over relative valuation column, largest to smallest. The fundamentally strongest stocks come to the top in terms of valuation. We can identify a stock to be fundamentally strong either in terms of valuation, for which we use the relative value column, and it can also be strong in terms of growth, for which we use the recent quarterly growths, and we may augment that with recent revenue growth as well. Quarterly earnings growth is more important to keep an eye on than revenue. WLH and TPH. These 2 stocks, WLH and TPH, they both have bright green earnings growth in recent quarters. In terms of valuation, the relative valuation column, their scores are in yellow. So they are moderately valued and are showing earnings growth. On top of that, WLH, this stock, has cyan color under short squeeze column, so it has a short squeeze potential. This may give interesting long opportunities, so I looked at their charts as well. Let's look at that. WLH, William Lyon Homes, in the weekly chart, it came to previous watermark level and since this earnings week, which had a very bullish shape candle, it is gradually going up. This week's candle is mixed in terms of shape. It has both upper as well as lower tail, though the body is hollow. The shape is mixed. The weekly candle backdrop color is bullish, cyan. In the daily chart, we can see earnings happened around this time. Just before that, a bullish headwind had appeared. That bullish headwind very nicely caught the very bottom. Amazing, isn't it? In fact, I see that prior to the drop, multiple bearish headwinds had appeared. Both of them could catch the very top, then this bullish headwind could catch the very bottom. I wonder how they are able to catch the top and bottom sometimes, but they indeed do. And it pays to be cautious when the signals come. After the earnings, it went up somewhat and then it moved sideways. When it was moving sideways, it was inside multiple memory resistance lines here and also support lines here and here. This week, on this green candle, it broke out of the narrow range, broke out above the watermark resistance. Then it went near the upper boundary and pulled down little bit. At the right edge, there is no trade opportunity. However, it has already made higher high in the daily chart. There is higher low because we see upward trending memory line is there. Now, if it comes down little bit and goes up again, gives us a cyan color candle that may give us a go with flow long trade opportunity. We may wait for that. This is the stock that has short squeeze potential as well. TriPoint, TPH, is the other home building stock that broke out of resistance in the daily chart. There were multiple memory resistance lines here. On this candle, it cleared all of them. It was a very bullish cyan candle. Shape was very bullish as well. On Friday, it pulled back a little bit. Weekly candle shape is somewhat mixed, has upper and lower tails. However, the backdrop candle color is bullish. In the daily chart, if it now comes down a little bit and goes up again, just like the other home building stock, this may also give go with flow long trade opportunity with low risk. Looking at the market's flip-flop, we may be extra careful and take such trade only if at least the industry is gaining momentum. The score is improving, the industry score for the home building industry is improving. It would be better if the market also starts to go up. Then we'll have all the factors aligned in this trade's favor. However, if the market is not going up strongly, neither is it going down strongly, moving sideways like in last 2 weeks, then we may take the trade based on the industry strength, the stock's fundamental strength, and certainly technical strength. May keep an eye on that. Let's now look at the worst performing industries. Remember, the best performing industries this week went up by between 2 to 4%. The worst performers went down by much bigger percentages, as we would expect, because all the sectors went down. The worst performers declined by between 4 to 7%. All the worst performers reversed from gain of the previous week, that is, they flip-flopped, again showing indecision in all of these industries. Tech sector we saw was the weakest sector. That weakness is demonstrated at industry level also. 7 of the 10 worst performers are from technology sector, and 3 of them are in fact in semiconductors. Semiconductors, and semiconductor equipment, and semiconductor equipment. If we kept an eye on tech's weakness, that was clearly visible from the bearish headwind signals, from the sector rotation, from the industry rotation, and also the semiconductor industry's weakness, then we could have some very profitable short trades in semiconductors. Umbrella, the spelling is actually AM, not UM, maybe umbrella. AMBA, Xilinx, XLNX, and Advanced Micro Devices, AMD. All of them gave go with flow short trade setups on same day, 22nd March. all were and all are still fundamentally overvalued as seen from Q score. So here we see three stocks in the same industry were overvalued and gave GoPro short signals on the same day. Just like bearish headwind coming in multiple stocks, same industry, same day gives us more confidence to take short. Multiple GoPro short trade opportunities coming in same industry at same time also gives us more confidence to take the short. Let's look at worst performing industries in QH. Drill down to the semiconductor stocks and then look at these three stocks through technical charts: AMBA, XLNX and AMT. In QH, for the sectors, we saw that information technology is weak, the weakest sector right now. When we go to industry tab to find the weakest industries, we sort over 5 days, smallest to largest. And many of the worst performers are in technology sector, like technology distributors, multiple semiconductor industries. These three semiconductor industries immediately catches the attention. They were all strong earlier, cyan color, for many months. In fact, many people were thinking of buying them at the very top. But in QA, we always stay away from buying at the top. Because we are regular traders, we could catch those same stocks at a much lower price. Why would we try to buy at the top, especially if the stocks were already fundamentally overvalued? Looking at the industry rotation, the weakening of the scores, which also showed up as the magenta color in recent periods, we could start looking for shorts. Let's look at the semiconductor stocks. Using scorecard, we can search for the semiconductor stocks. We can sort for overvalued stocks using the relative valuation column, smallest to largest. And we see umbrella, AMBA, AMD, and Xilinx, XLNX. All of these three stocks are having relative value score in magenta color. That is, they were overvalued and they are still overvalued. On top of that, AMBA. Out of these three stocks, AMBA, we can see, was having weakening earnings growth as well. So if we were going to short the stocks, we could short all of them. If we are going to pick only one of the three stocks for shorting, then we could pick AMBA. It had even more weakness than the other two stocks. Remember, all three of them gave GoPro short trade setup on the same day, 22nd March. Sometimes people don't want to enter multiple trades in the same industry. These were three short setups coming in three stocks on same day in same industry. So if you were going to pick only one based on fundamentals at least, you would pick AMBA. And that is very easily selected from this vital scorecard. All of them were magenta color. Relative valuation wise, all of them were weak. And in terms of growth, earnings growth, and even revenue growth, I can see AMBA was the weakest. Let's look at their charts now to see how they had given GoPro short trade setups on the same day. There is a question on CRI and NPTN. CRI and NPTN are also weak on fundamentals. Finally, we'll take a trade looking at the technical charts also. CRI probably didn't have a suitable opportunity at that time on 22nd March. Let's have a look at CRI and then look at the other three stocks. This is CRI. Fundamentally, it is overvalued. I think growth-wise also, it is not very good. However, finally, we'll take a short trade only if there is a proper trade setup. There is no proper GoPro or headwind or any such swing short trade setup in CRI in recent times. at the right edge, I can see it has a bearish shape candle. Activity was high on this Friday. Weekly candle color is bearish, but the shape is bullish. Still, next week, if it tilts down in the daily chart, gives us a magenta color candle, then will give us a going flow short trade setup. We may take it if the industry is continuing to weaken at that time. That will align all the forces in the trade's favor. Fundamentals are weak, industry would be weak, and technically we'll have a proper setup. So we may keep an eye on CRE. If the market starts to go down next week, CRE may give us an opportunity next week. This is AMBA. On this day, this was 22nd March, we had a very clear going flow short trade setup. Interestingly, we had all the four direction lines crossed at the same time on this day. It doesn't happen usually, very rare in fact. Our going flow short trade setup requirement is only magenta and cyan direction lines to tilt down. Sometimes we have three of them coming together, maybe magenta, cyan, white, or magenta, cyan, yellow. And on this day, we had all the four direction lines coming together and price quite sharply going below all of them. So we could take a short trade at that point, putting stop just above the recent high here. And as price hit lower boundary, we could book per share profit. As the industry is weakening, weekly candle is very bearish in terms of shape color, daily is also pretty bearish, there is no need to exit full position, we can continue to hold partial position. Let's look at the other two stocks. XLNX made a nice double top here. In fact, if somebody was keeping an eye on the watermark resistance in weekly and daily both, then one could take a short trade based on this price drop. This was a false upside breakout at a watermark resistance level that was there in both weekly and daily. And it was accompanied by very high activity that met all the conditions of a box short trade setup. Stop would be just above recent high, then we would make significant profit. This was 22nd March. This was also a short trade opportunity. Here, price broke below three of the direction lines with a very bearish shape and bearish color candle. So we could take a short trade at that point, putting stop just above recent high, and we could book partial profit at the lower boundary. Again, weekly and daily both are very bearish, industry is bearish, fundamentals is still overvalued, there is no reason to close enter position. AMD, the third semiconductor stock, AMD gave us a going flow short trade setup on this candle, magenta color candle. This was also a magenta color candle. We could take a short trade at that point if this memory support was not there. Because there was a memory line right at that point, we would not be taking any short trade at the close of this candle. However, next day it tried to go up and following day it broke down again with a magenta color candle. Price was near value area, we could take a short at that time, and as it hit lower boundary, we could book profit. Here the weekly is more bullish in terms of shape than the other two stocks. Still, the industry is weak. Fundamentals of this stock is also weak. One could book full position profit or one could continue to hold partial position. Again, because three of the stocks in same industry gave same go with flow short trade setup on same day and all were overvalued in terms of fundamentals, we could take the short trade more confidently. Let's go back to the semiconductor stocks that we studied just now. AMD, AMBA and Xilinx, and look at their fundamental scorecard little bit more closely. See, all three of them are overvalued. In terms of growth, earnings growth, one is weaker than others. AMD has very robust growth, earnings growth. Year over year, quarterly earnings growth is very high, and it was accelerating 140% to 233% to 900%. If the earnings growth is accelerating so much, what happened to the stock? Let's review the stock again. AMD. It has already fallen down. In the weekly chart also we see that, in the daily chart also we see that. That shows that even if a stock is having earnings growth, all kinds of growth, price can still fall down. All these fundamentals are very useful to shortlist stocks for potential long or short trade, but finally we must trade based on what the technical charts are saying. So AMD's growth was good, it was overvalued, but growth was very good. Still the stock fell down. By the time the growth will weaken, stock would have fallen already. Probably some people knows what is going on much before it is known to the public through quarterly reports. So the stock price usually goes up or down before the fundamentals turn around. That is something that we need to keep in mind. So I added this observation and comment here. Studying how the semi stocks prices drop from their peaks and their EPS growth of past quarters, you may find that price drop preceded EPS growth drop, which is common phenomenon. It was not a one-off case of these stocks. That is why Q traders use stock fundamental scores to shortlist stocks for buying or selling, and then use Q trade setups to pinpoint actual buy point or sell point. We are not going to buy a stock just because its fundamentals are strong, because fundamentals are usually lagging very much actually for swing trading purpose, and even for long-term investment it pays a little better if we finally buy using technical charts. We can always shortlist stocks using fundamentals. That is an important thing to keep in mind, not to buy just based on fundamentals. We study the accelerating industries because they tend to be the best performers of subsequent weeks. Energy sector was the strongest this week. That is very different from US oil's performance. Let's go back to US oil chart again. From the weekly candle, we see oil dropped sharply. It has a very solid candle and also magenta color candle in the weekly chart. So oil dropped heavily. Now let us go back to QH sector analysis. Over 5 days, that's 1 week period, we see energy is actually the best performing sector. That is showing up in the accelerating industries as well. Five of the accelerating industries are in energy sector. These are coal and consumable fuels, oil and gas drilling, energy equipment and services, oil and gas equipment services, and oil and gas storage and transportation. If we look at QH heat map, then we'll see oil and gas drilling accelerated after weakness, and this stock, we had discussed this earlier, unit COP, UNT, is optimally valued and completed false downside breakout in daily chart, weekly supported by memory. You may look for potential long in this stock. Let's look at the accelerating industries in QH. To find the accelerating industries, we sort over pace 5 days column, largest to smallest. We see multiple energy related industries are there. Coal, consumer fuel, oil and gas drilling, etc. Oil and gas drilling is one which was weak earlier, tried to gain strength, weaken, and now gain strength. And the acceleration is very good, the second most accelerating industry. Let's look at the oil and gas drilling stocks from scorecard. These are the oil and gas drilling stocks, and we find this stock UNT is optimally valued. It had some nice earnings growth in past two quarters. This quarter, the last quarter, earnings growth declined again. Revenue growth is steady over the last three quarters. It is optimally valued. Let's look at the chart of UNT. Few things in favor of long possible setup is the memory support lines in the weekly chart and two successive weeks of very bullish shape candle. In last week, activity was extremely high. So this price support was from the bulls. This high activity was from the bulls. Otherwise, we will not have two successive weeks of bullish shape candles. In the daily chart, there were multiple memory resistance lines when the stock was going down. As of Thursday, all the memory resistance lines, at least three of them, 1, 2, 3, they are showing up as dotted lines now, interstation. They are all broken. There is no memory resistance in daily nearby. There is a memory resistance in weekly, but that is far away, near 26 price. Now price is around 29, 24. If it goes up again next week, it may give us a low risk entry opportunity in this stock. However, we need to keep an eye on the market also. I keep on saying market is very indecisive right now. We may easily get whipsawed. So better to be cautious. If you need to take a trade, then may consider taking trade in this stock if the setup comes next week. Decelerating industries, these are the ones that tend to be worst performer in subsequent weeks. Earlier, I mentioned that there is some cautionary signal regarding real estate. Over 1 month, it is one of the only two sectors that went up. However, I see this week, three of the decelerating industries are in real estate sector. Industrial rates, real estate management and development, and real estate services. All the decelerating industries were significant gainers in the previous week. Previous week, they went up by between 3.9 to 6.1%. This week, all of them declined, but by much smaller percentages, by 0.8 to 2.5%. This flip-flop shows indecision. At the same time, the percentages show the market is not as weak as it had been in recent past down weeks. We saw the same observation from the sector percentage flip-flop as well. Let's summarize. We saw that last week we had many indecisive weekly candles, both in broad indices as well as broad market ETFs. That indecisiveness increased even more this week. This week we have wider range candles, but all the candles are now indecisive. Last week we had at least one weekly candle, that of NYSE broad index, somewhat bullish. This week we don't have a single bullish shaped candle among the four broad market ETFs and two broad market indices. We see massive flip-flop, not only at the sector level, sectors going down 1 week, up next week, again down this week, but also at the internals level. Advance decline as well as up down volume for both the broad market indices went down 1 week, up next week, and down this week again. That means this flip-flop is happening across the whole market, not only at the market leading stocks, not only at the weakest stocks, but across the whole market. In fact, the stocks that were at the very top, or that stocks that were at the very bottom, they are not changing much. How we know that? If they were changing much, meaning if the leading stocks were continuing to go up, then we will see that in new high low. Or if the worst performers are continuing to go down, we will see that also in new high lows. But new high lows hardly changed. It is becoming less instrumental in moving the market right now. Last week itself, we had difficulty finding suitable trade opportunities. This week, it became even harder. We have some possible setups that we may keep an eye on and be very careful, take the trades only if the market is showing some clarity in terms of its direction. Otherwise, it may be safe to stay away from the market. That is all that I plan to share in today's session. Thank you for attending. I look forward to seeing you in our next session. Have a great weekend and trade profitably.